Sorry, I got to get up to grab the mic here. I always find it funny because everybody's on that side. Probably want to see the hands. Okay, so I started with Prelude to the Holberg Suite by Edvard Grieg. So, being a Norwegian and playing Edvard Grieg, it's kind of like I have to do that. And that's also how my concert career started in 2007 when I started touring the States and playing music by Edvard Grieg for his 100th anniversary. So it's almost become sort of a niche of mine to play and present Norwegian music. So Edvard Grieg was important for Norwegians because we were under Danish rule for 400 years. And we got our constitution in 1814. And Grieg was born just a couple of decades later. So Norway was in a process of rediscovering their identity as a nation. So we got the National Romantic Movement. We tried to find the roots of the Norwegian culture. So Grieg did a great job of creating a kind of classical music to give the Norwegian people like a national identity through music. By a lot of inspiration from folk music. So I'm going to do a little Grieg, and then I'm going to proceed to a composer you probably haven't heard of, Geirr Tveitt. He's sort of the next generation. So he wrote a lot of music from about 1930 up until 1960. I'm going to tell you more about him when we get there. But I think the most important piece of this program would be the first piece after the intermission, which is sort of a US premiere. And this is a piece that I commissioned from this composer. And I'm really happy to be able to present this to American audiences on this tour for the first time. I premiered it in Norway in March. So I'm going to just keep playing some Grieg for you. First, peasant dances. This is real Norwegian folk music written for fiddle. We have a special kind of fiddle called the Hardanger fiddle, which has 8 strings. So it's really much used in folk music. So Grieg adapted this to the piano. So this is the Goblin's Bridal Procession over Vossavangen, is a lake in Norway. So the idea is that it's like a wedding in the spirit world. So this wedding procession is hovering above this lake. So there's a lot of natural mysticism from the Norwegian folklore. Then I'm going to do 3 lyric pieces. I'm not going to tell you too much about those, but obviously Grieg is very well known for his lyric pieces. He wrote 10 books and some of his greatest achievements. He really liked this small format, and he experimented a lot with harmonics. So this was a good fit for him to write small lyric pieces. So I hope you enjoy the concert.
Thank you.
Some of you have heard the last piece, at least. Wedding Day at Trolltåget probably is most famous and his best lyric piece. It's really sparkling. Trollhagen, by the way, is the name of the place where Edvard Grieg settled down. It's outside of Bergen, Norway. It's not a place per se, but troll means like a troll, right? And Haugen means like a hill, like a, not a pile, you know, like a hill where you put a house on top. So that's the name. He built a little house up there, and it's a museum today. So if you come to Norway, you have to go there. Personally, I haven't been there, which is really ashamed of. It's rather ironic. Okay, Geirr Tveitt. He was born the year after Grieg died, 1908, and he died the year I was born, 1981. I have very good contact with the daughter of the composer. She's really excited about me presenting her father's music here in the States. So this is a composer that was really, for me, he's the most interesting composer after Grieg. And there's so many things I could say and I want to say about Tveitt, but I don't want to give too much emphasis on the lecture part of this performance, so I'd rather go back to playing. But to try to be a little short, he had this enormous energy and enormous visions of how to create a new kind of tonality for Norwegian music. He even wrote a book where he laid out his whole music theory based on his way of thinking about harmony and voicing. Basically, he's using a lot of modality. I'm going a little technical because we're at a university and some of the students might be familiar with that. So you hear a lot of modality, not regular major and minor scales, but the kind of scales you'll find in nature and in natural instruments and folk music. But the interesting thing about Tveitt is that between Grieg and Tveitt, we had Impressionism. And that became very popular in Norway for some reason. So here we have this really archaic sounding Norwegian, some of it is based on Norwegian folk songs. Like the first three pieces are based on folk songs that he collected from around the place he lived. And it's called Hardanger. It's a very, very beautiful fjord called Hardanger Fjord. And I just visited his farm there. It's still around, and the view he had, I mean, you can just imagine when you listen to some of these pieces and you can just, okay, if you had the view he had, then you would get inspired to write music yourself. Really nice. But you have these old, sort of, old-sounding folk music on top of, like, Ravel, very impressionistic sounds. And sometimes when he gets barbaric, he's called the Bartok of the North. So he has this duality. He has the Ravel and he has the Bartok. And I'm going to try to show you both of them. So first three Hardanger tunes. And then I'm going to play a piece which is unpublished. And I think I got this almost like a gift from the daughter because I'm promoting her father here in the States. So this is more of a private piece. But it's so beautiful that I have to play it. It is recorded on a Naxos label from my former teacher. But you have to get exclusive access to this piece, so you can't buy it. It's unpublished. So this is a menuet that he wrote as a birthday present for one of his teachers, pretty famous Nadia Boulanger in Paris, where he studied for a while. So I'm going to play those four, and I'm going to introduce the last one separately. Thank you.
Thank you.
of the sun god. So, there's one tragic thing that I have to mention when it comes to Geirr Tveitt. He's probably the most productive composer we've had in Norway. Unfortunately, in 1970, his farmhouse burned to the ground. And with it, probably 70-80% of everything he wrote. Because he probably wrote faster than he could publish. And he also wrote a whole lot after the Second World War. And times were difficult in Norway then. So there are several reasons, but he had trouble getting things published right away. And most of what he wrote is actually gone. Some has been restored. They found fragments in the fire. Not everything was completely lost. So some pieces are still popping up, where you have modern technology being used to decipher burnt pages, for instance. And then you have composers filling in missing parts and reconstructing pieces. But I also mentioned about his visionary quality. So Geirr Tveitt, he wanted to recreate a sense of archaic mythology. He was very interested in Norse mythology. He read the old texts of that. And he had very clear ideas how this could sound. A lot of parallel fifths and the way he writes. So the next piece, The Dance of the Sun God, is kind of like a ritualistic dance. And this piano piece is based on themes of a large work, like a three-hour ballet, called The Dreams of Baldur. And that's one of the pieces that Tveitt wrote early, like in the 30s. And then he thought it was gone forever. But they found a copy in England after he was dead. So most of it was reconstructed, and it's, you can find it if you're on Spotify, and you can find a lot of Geirr Tveitt, including Baldur's Dreams. So the sun god sort of comes down here, and there's a ritual, like a dance. So it's a very sort of monotonous piece. It's the theme is only three notes. So it sort of pounds along for several minutes. So I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
hope you're enjoying some Norwegian music tonight. I'm going to continue with Norwegian music. This is like the next step, contemporary Norwegian music. And this is really the first time I've been involved with commissioning a whole new piece like this. So this is a professor from the University of Trondheim, where I got my master's degree. But he's one of the most well-known and most commissioned composers in Norway. And just this year, he was actually Grammy nominated for his opera called David and Bathsheba. So he didn't win the Grammy, but just to get the nomination was great. So he's pretty much out there. I think he also he recorded his Requiem in Washington, D.C. So he's still an international composer, even though he's kind of local for me. I mean, he's a teacher at my university. So his music is sometimes called Neo-Impressionism. And you'll probably hear why. He's also enjoying putting together these wonderful sounds and soundscapes. His music is tonal, for the most part, but in this sort of very sound-based realm. You know. What else can I say about him? Yeah, the title, Ruf und Nachklang, is a German title. So it means something like call and response, but it's not the same. So I don't know if you know German, but it's more like Ruf would be more like an outcry, and Nachklang would be like an after sound that comes afterwards. It's like a yell and then the subtle sounds that come. So it's built around that contrast. So both movements have the same motive. There are two short motives, and everything is based on that. So in the first movement, he's sort of compressing the motives a little bit with more like a development section in the middle. And in the second movement, he's just sort of elaborating and building these wonderful long soundscapes for us. So I really enjoy the piece, and I'm really privileged and happy to be able to perform it. And I hope you enjoy it too.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to end this program tonight with something which is not Norwegian, but American and Russian put together. So these are Rachmaninov songs, transcribed to the piano by the American Earl Wilde. And how many have heard of Earl Wilde? Yep, quite a few, but still, I was shocked the first time I played something of Earl Wilde. It was some Gershwin transcriptions I played of his. And I just took it for granted that the American audiences knew about Earl Wilde. I thought he was as famous as Van Cliburn. Because I heard of Earl Wilde for a long time ago, so maybe he's more popular in Europe. And I can easily say that this is one of my favorite pianists ever. So Lauren is very right when she says, just go to YouTube and anything you'll find of Earl Wilde is definitely worth checking out. And if you're on Spotify, I know that I think almost his entire discography has been put out on Spotify as well. So this is a man that was born in 1915, and he knew Rachmaninoff, and he was brought up in the golden age of piano. And he died in 2010, and he was active as a pianist up until the very last few years. So I remember just coming here, I listened to a transcription of the Mexican Hat Dance. And he played that when he was 88. And if you didn't know that, you'd probably guess he was 25. So again, I sincerely urge you to check out Earl Wilde. I think he hasn't had the fame that he deserves in this country. I don't know why. Maybe I think sometimes those things are a little coincidental. Some people just do a lot of great work and don't get the proper recognition for it. So Earl Wilde, wonderful pianist and transcriber, because he brought the art of transcription from the very school of Franz Liszt back in the 1800s. And this, these Rachmaninoff songs are some kind of a treasure, I think. Not very well known at all. And I haven't heard any other recording than Earl Wilde himself playing them. So again, if you're a pianist, you might want to look at these pieces. They're not easy, but it's worth it, I think. So I hope you have enjoyed the program, and till next time.